Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Katrina, A History, 1915 to 2015, by Andy Horowitz. Narrated by George Newbern. Introduction. On September 29, 1915, at the muddy end of the Mississippi's farthest reach into the Gulf of Mexico, 100 miles downriver from New Orleans, an unnamed hurricane made landfall. An anemometer recorded wind gusts of 140 miles per hour there at the town of Burwood, Louisiana, where on easier days several hundred members of the Army Corps of Engineers lived in orderly cottages and worked to keep the shipping canal at the river's mouth clear of sediment. As the storm moved upriver, the aneroid barometer at Tulane University plummeted to 28.10 inches. The rain gauge filled with 8.36 inches of precipitation in 21 hours. Even in a region accustomed to hurricanes, these were extraordinary measurements. Isaac Klein, the chief meteorologist at the United States Weather Bureau in New Orleans, reported that the storm was the most intense hurricane of which we have record in the history of the Mexican Gulf Coast, and probably in the United States. But meteorology is not meaning. On their own, these data reveal little about how the storm might have mattered to people, or how they might have responded to it. These precise metrics of wind speed, rainfall, and barometric pressure do not trace the shape of life in places that seem repeatedly to come under assault from the forces of nature. We need different tools to gauge those times when coincidences of earth, wind, and water upset the course of human events in ways so overwhelming that we name them with a word whose basic meaning suggests that the entire universe is out of joint. Disaster. Consider that during the 1915 hurricane across the state of Louisiana, 275 people died. Property damage estimates ran to $12 million, $280 million in 2015 dollars. Upriver from Burwood, only four houses remained standing in the town called Empire. East of New Orleans in St. Bernard Parish, the settlement of St. Malo was washed from the map entirely. That village bore the name of Jean St. Malo, who in the 1780s had led a group of Africans trying to escape from slavery. Eventually captured by Spanish authorities, St. Malo was executed in 1784 in front of the Cabildo in the historic center square of New Orleans, where the hurricane winds had sent pieces of slate flying from the steeple of St. Louis Cathedral. A foot of water remained in parts of the city for 5 days. Nonetheless, once the storm passed, many New Orleanians celebrated. Stormproof. The record shows Orleans, the newspaper proclaimed after the hurricane. The mayor quickly rejected outside offers of aid. Surveying the event a month later, the New Orleans Sewerage and Water Board, the agency charged with protecting the city from floods, concluded that its new drainage system had passed a defining test. It is safe to say, its report asserted, that no city anywhere in the world could have withstood these conditions with less damage and less inconvenience than has New Orleans. Marshaling statistics from meteorologists like Isaac Klein, the report reasoned that the recent extreme occurrence of wind and rain renders more remote the probability of a repetition of any of these things in the early future. It was a curious logic in a city that had seen 92 hurricanes or tropical storms since its European colonial founding in 1718. Despite this history, the Sewerage and Water Board believed that even if another big storm came, New Orleans would be safe. The report's authors reflected on the storm's lessons this way. There is no reason why this city and its surrounding country should not continue even more successfully than heretofore, its developments in all directions. The experience of the 1915 hurricane affirmed the consensus among engineers and investors, city planners and politicians, home builders and home buyers, that New Orleans should grow. The city they created became one of the most celebrated places in the world. Ain't no city like the one I'm from, the women in the original Pinette's Brass Band sang a century later. New Orleans admirers lauded it as the land of dreams, the Big Easy, the city that care forgot, America's most interesting city, and the soul of America. With its jazz, Mardi Gras, and other iconic contributions to world culture, More than any other place in America, New Orleans called to mind creativity, cosmopolitanism, and love of life. But today, New Orleans also calls to mind catastrophe. The city drowned when its levee system collapsed on August 29, 2005, killing hundreds of people, destroying thousands of homes, and precipitating not only one of the most horrific moments in modern American history, but offering an emblem for the idea of disaster itself. Katrina. The response to the 1915 storm thus cast a century-long shadow, because the new neighborhoods developed after that storm experienced the worst flooding in 2005. More than any other single factor, including the race or class of its inhabitants, the age of a building best predicted how it would fare in 2005. Tracing the outline of the Katrina flood reveals the shape of New Orleans as it stood nine decades earlier. Most houses built before 1915 did not flood, but most houses built after the Sewerage and Water Board's 1915 call for further growth did. Usually we imagine disasters as exceptions. We describe them as external attacks, ahistorical acts of God, blows from without. That is why most accounts of Katrina begin when the levees broke and conclude not long after. But these stories offer a denuded sense of what happened, why or what might have prevented the catastrophe. Somebody had to build the levees before they could break. I begin the story of Katrina in 1915 in order to pursue a different idea, that disasters come from within. Disasters are less discrete events than they are contingent processes. Seemingly acute incidents like the largely forgotten 1915 hurricane live on as the lessons they teach, the decisions they prompt, and the accommodations they oblige. Their causes and consequences stretch across much longer periods of time and space than we commonly imagine. Seeing disasters in history and as history demonstrates that the places we live and the disasters that imperil them are at once artifacts of state policy, cultural imagination, economic order, and environmental possibility. Katrina's causes and consequences reach across a century. The 1915 Sewerage and Water Board report shaped the rationale for developing the neighborhoods that flooded in 2005. Wrangling over fur trapping rights in the 1920s in St. Bernard Parish shaped a legal struggle for offshore oil in the 1940s, which shaped Louisiana's economy in the 1950s, the state's coastline in the 1970s, and the state's coastal master plan to confront land loss in the 2010s. When the Industrial Canal, dredged for shipping interests in 1918, flooded the homes of veterans during Hurricane Betsy in 1965, the memory of sharecropping shaped how African Americans interpreted the Small Business Administration loans they were offered as disaster relief. The memory of Hurricane Betsy shaped how New Orleanians responded when the Industrial Canal broke again under the weight of Hurricane Katrina's storm surge in 2005. The promise of the Federal Housing Act of 1937 shaped the claims that residents made for a right of return to public housing in 2007. The Louisiana State Engineers dynamited a levee in St. Bernard Parish in 1927, which shaped fears in 1965 and 2005 that politicians had lit another fuse. The mutual benefit associations African Americans developed during Reconstruction to provide burial insurance shaped the social aid and pleasure clubs that offered Louisiana its most popular metaphor for recovery, the jazz funeral. When Jesse Jackson declared in 2005 that filled with stranded African-American Katrina victims, New Orleans's convention center looked like the hull of a slave ship, he was admonishing all who heard him that disasters offer no escape from the past. And yet, if understanding history usually demands drawing connections between seemingly disparate dots, trying to make sense of what happened in Louisiana after August 29, 2005, also poses the opposite problem, because the hurricane called Katrina did not cause many of the effects commonly attributed to it. After the storm passed, New Orleans police officers shot and killed unarmed citizens. The Federal Emergency Management Agency gave flood victims trailers laced with formaldehyde. The New Orleans City Council voted to demolish the city's public housing apartments. The Louisiana State Legislature voted to transform the city's public school system into a confederacy of charter schools. Congress voted to fund the largest housing recovery program in United States history. The program appropriated money to homeowners, but not to renters. New Orleans police officers arrested musicians for leading jazz funerals without permits, while violent crime plagued the city. Louisiana State University shut down New Orleans' public charity hospital, while rates of mental illness surged. The Army Corps of Engineers encircled the city with a new levee system, while the wetlands beyond the walls continued to erode and the city itself continued to sink. A decade after the storm, New Orleans' population had fallen from 484,674 to 390,711. Of the people missing, the vast majority, nearly 92,000 people, were African American. We have come to refer to this sequence of events as Katrina. But for none of these effects was the hurricane the proximate cause. The flood line thus tells one important story, but it is not the only story that matters. Americans have never left our destiny to the whims of nature, President George W. Bush declared in September 2005, and we will not start now. After the flood receded, policymakers reapportioned the challenges the water had posed. Legislators designed recovery programs that favored white people over African American people, wealthy people over poor people, and people who owned homes over people who rented them. These policies reinforced existing inequalities, and they often undermined what the many Louisianians who opposed them argued were essential facts of life: the bonds of family, the solidarity of community, notions of political legitimacy, feelings of cultural belonging, and a sense of moral order. The etymology of the word disaster refers to stars out of alignment, but if the changes in Louisiana after Hurricane Katrina seemed to some to proceed with the force of destiny, it is well to remember, as Shakespeare cautioned, the fault is not in our stars, but in ourselves, that we are underlings. Katrina brings together several of the defining concerns of our time. The climate crisis that seems at once to have revealed the power of humans to change the world and the powerlessness of humans to control those changes. The fossil-fueled growth that made single-family homes affordable and vulnerable. The infrastructure that is not up to a warming world. The ongoing state of emergency and the corresponding yearning for sustainability and resilience. The racism that rends our communities. The crushing inequality. The sometimes reckless, sometimes revolutionary hope that the future might be better than the past. None of these are unique to Louisiana. They define the United States in the 21st century. Hurricane Sandy in New York and New Jersey, Hurricane Harvey in Texas, Hurricane Maria in Puerto Rico, and other frighteningly similar events have demonstrated what many Louisianians always understood, that New Orleans' history is America's history, and that Katrina is America's possible future. We often see our problems as unprecedented, but the crises we face challenge the legitimacy of state action, the moral basis of our economy, and the processes of culture that give life its meaning. These are among the most enduring human problems. History can help reveal the range of possible solutions. This book, therefore, means to offer Katrina's history while at the same time suggesting new, more capacious ways to make sense of disasters in general. I grapple with the unsettling truth that disasters have histories. The chapters that follow challenge distinctions between acute catastrophe and enduring trauma, between the natural and the man-made, between cities and their suburban and rural surrounds, and between conservative and liberal politics, while clarifying distinctions among definitions of recovery in the halls of Congress and on the streets of devastated neighborhoods. I engage in a broad search for causes and consequences, asking questions across the fields of urban history, environmental history, Southern history, and African American history, and incorporating insights from sociology, anthropology, geography, and economics in order to explore the relationship between structural inequality and physical infrastructure. I draw from the archives of congressmen and communists, the Army Corps and oil companies, and use city plans, geological surveys, oral histories, census records, and jazz records in order to understand how disasters force people to reckon with the causes of inequality, to debate the proper role of government, and to make sense of change itself. This book addresses three overarching questions. Why did people live in such dangerous places? What made these places dangerous? And how could this happen in the United States? These were the questions that many cried at their televisions as they watched 80% of New Orleans and nearly all of neighboring St. Bernard Parish fill with water in the late summer of 2005. Scholars and policymakers have struggled with these questions since, because they are not only about Louisiana, but about how to make sense of 20th and 21st century America. And these questions haunt us still, especially as people increasingly understand that Katrina is not receding safely into the past, but looming ever larger as a portent of the future. I can outline the book's answers to the first two questions quickly. Why do people live in such dangerous places? People live there because for over a century, federal programs, including the Swamp Land Acts, the GI Bill, the Disaster Relief Act, the National Flood Insurance Program, and levee building itself, have encouraged building and rebuilding in flood-prone places. What made these places so dangerous? They were not always. Rather, they were made increasingly so over the course of the 20th century because the benefits of Louisiana's most lucrative industries, shipping and oil, were not first allocated to mitigating their costs, creating a dramatic imbalance of private profits and public liabilities. This arrangement prompted a stunning collapse of land into water, an existential crisis for Louisiana that the new levee system constructed after 2005 did little to address. The third question, how could this happen in the United States, requires more discussion. Before the 2005 flood, many imagined that somehow American citizenship promised to prevent such terrible suffering. And still, after the flood, many continued to claim that Katrina would never have happened in a place like New York City. They meant that the promises that American citizenship made to wealthy white people, at least, would protect them from ravages they believed affected only poor African Americans in New Orleans. Most people who made such statements meant them as a critique of racism and economic inequality. They may not have recognized how the critique rested on the idea of American exceptionalism. But carving out an exception for New Orleans, or the poor, or African Americans, insidiously shielded everywhere and everyone else. This was dangerously naive. Asserting that Katrina's flood only affected people on the margins of society deafens all of us to the siren of its warning. Racism and poverty are necessary beacons for navigating Katrina's history because they structure American inequality, often leading to inequities so stark they can be fatal. Yet at times they can offer insufficient explanations for the suffering cataloged here. This is particularly true when it comes to flood vulnerability. Many observers have assumed or asserted that in New Orleans, as one scholar put it, topographic gradients doubled as class and race gradients, but the truth is more complicated. When the levees broke, the homes of tens of thousands of suburban middle-class white people flooded catastrophically, while the homes of New Orleans' poorest African-American residents who lived in public housing largely did not. There are no straight lines that connect racism or poverty to flood depths. Instead, I demonstrate that while racism set the stage for whose homes flooded, it took a circuitous route to doing so. The flood was not the result of racist policies or practices in the years directly before the levee breaches in 2005. Rather, racism in federal housing policies from the 1930s through the 1960s, including redlining, segregation, and veterans affairs loans that went disproportionately to white people, all enabled the white middle class to move into new homes. Since the only available land was on lower ground in new neighborhoods and suburbs, these homes were located there, while many African Americans continued to live in the inner city. The older parts of the city were on higher ground, therefore confining African-American families to the older parts of New Orleans, ironically, spared them from some of the flooding. While the same racist housing policies put white people and the African-American people who managed to access them at risk. It is worth lingering on that last point. Racist housing policies moved a predominantly white population to new neighborhoods that came with new streets, new schools, more valuable homes, and largely invisible to many of their inhabitants, greater flood risk. African Americans were left to older neighborhoods, deemed less desirable in most ways, although they had the lost-to-view benefit of being at higher elevations. The Lower Ninth Ward offers an exception that proves the rule. The African-American neighborhood was low-lying and subject to a devastating wall of water in 2005, but it had not been home to the city's most marginalized citizens. Rather, it had been built by and for middle-class African-Americans, who had found ways to access the benefits of the local, state, and federal commitments to metropolitan growth and homeownership. In the long run, the policies and practices that once seemed to enable American progress created catastrophic vulnerability. People who lived in flood-prone parts of metropolitan New Orleans generally did not live there because they were disadvantaged. Rather, they lived there because they had been able to take advantage of the government subsidies required to develop housing in low-lying parts of the region. More broadly, they had benefited from the redistributional policies that created the American middle class and defined the post-World War II American dream. The liberal desire to expand the welfare state, combined with a conservative desire to privatize the ensuing growth, this uneasy but expansive détente built America in the 20th century and imperils it in the 21st. It has no better emblem than the federal levee system that surrounded metropolitan New Orleans from the late 1960s until its failure in 2005. The levee system was one of the largest public works projects in United States history. A physical promise of a national commitment to the safety, well-being, and growth of the communities it encircled. But its foundations were not steady enough. And when the system collapsed, those with power tried to prop it back up for themselves on the backs of the already disadvantaged. The book is divided into two parts. The two halves hinge on the day the levees broke. Dividing the book this way is meant to recognize the importance of that deadly collapse, but also to emphasize that it is what happened before and after the levee failures that gave Katrina its significance. I also look beyond the levee system because urban history ought more often to be written and understood at the scale of environmental history without losing sight of how change is experienced at the local level. People in New Orleans and its suburbs have long depended on what happens beyond their modern-day city walls. Part 1 of the book describes the construction of Louisiana's vulnerability, starting with an explosion. In April 1927, 15 miles downriver from French Quarter, Louisiana state engineers dynamited the Mississippi River levee, flooding the homes of thousands of farmers, fishermen, and fur trappers in St. Bernard and Plaquemines parishes in an attempt to protect New Orleans from the river's high water. The blast signaled the failure of a century's worth of piecemeal attempts to control the Mississippi. It heralded, too, a confluence of state power, political ideology, and flood control policy, a regime that enabled politicians and engineers to restructure the earth and how people lived on it in ways that protected and enriched some at the expense of endangering and impoverishing others. In the 1890s, the wetlands of Plaquemines and St. Bernard parishes, the counties that framed the 100-mile stretch of the Mississippi River from New Orleans to the Gulf of Mexico, were granted to local levee boards to manage in the service of flood control. The marshes seemed worthless then, but after the 1927 flood, they were discovered to hold enormous deposits of oil and gas. Flood protection and industrial development thus became intertwined, and often conflicting processes. The struggle played out over decades in a small-scale war between fur trappers who used the coastal marshes and common multinational industrial firms like Standard Oil, which sought to exploit the oil resources, and, as brokers between the two, politicians like Plaquemines and St. Bernard Parish District Attorney Leander Perez. Decisions made during this period caused Louisiana to begin sinking rapidly into the Gulf of Mexico. Since the 1930s, more than 2,000 square miles of Louisiana have been lost to the water, and metropolitan New Orleans has become far more vulnerable to floods. Chapter 2 brings the focus upriver to tell the story of 1965's Hurricane Betsy. Betsy was the defining historical precedent for Katrina and the formative event by which Louisianians made sense of Katrina. During Betsy, a storm surge overwhelmed the Industrial Canal and flooded the city's Lower Ninth Ward, devastating a neighborhood that exemplified both the possibilities and limits for African Americans working to enter the middle class in the decades following World War II. After the flood, debates about disaster relief exploded into a broad struggle over civil rights and urban development, as African-American women and white Southern politicians fought to define the disaster and to shape relief programs. Many residents of the Lower Ninth believed that local officials had bombed the levees, as they had in St. Bernard in 1927, that their unequal suffering had been caused by government decisions. It followed, therefore, that the government owed them reparations. When they failed to get the help they believed they were entitled to, many African Americans in the Lower Ninth came to believe that not only had the government caused the flood in the first place, it also had broken a promise to help them recover from it. In contrast, the white men who controlled Democratic politics, both in Louisiana and in Washington, understood the Betsy disaster to be an act of God that government had no role in causing and no special obligation to fix. They welcomed disaster aid not as reparations but as charity and as a tonic for federal fractures over civil rights. Put another way, Betsy prompted a debate over the causes of inequality and the promises of citizenship. Chapter 3 charts the accelerated pace of metropolitan growth and coastal land loss after Hurricane Betsy, focusing on suburban development in St. Bernard Parish. After Betsy, Congress authorized the Lake Pontchartrain and Vicinity Hurricane Protection Project and the National Flood Insurance Program. These major federal investments were meant to forestall the next flood disaster. They ultimately magnified it. The new federal levee system was designed to protect, and the new flood insurance program encouraged, development across a much larger metropolitan region, a geography enabled by oil and gas. For decades following Betsy, federal policies encouraged Americans to move to these new neighborhoods in order to join the middle class. Many people imagine New Orleans to be exotic, but the Katrina flood washed over quintessential 20th century American landscapes. Chapter 3 highlights the growing chorus of critics warning of the threats caused by Louisiana's oil industry, land loss, and an ethos that pitted individual economic progress against community security, including keen predictions of what ultimately occurred when Hurricane Katrina made landfall. But metropolitan growth offered a seductive solution to social problems for much of the 20th century and proved difficult to abandon even in the face of looming catastrophe. Part 2 of the book covers Hurricane Katrina and the decade that followed. Chapter 4 focuses on the levee failures and the immediate responses to them in August and September 2005. An inept rescue operation, calls for New Orleans to be abandoned, and a series of racist attacks on African Americans shaped how people understood what was happening and influenced policy responses. The flood renewed a struggle over the meaning of American citizenship that had endured since Hurricane Betsy, revealing a polity still deeply fractured over conflicting visions of race, nature, government, community, and change itself. Some Louisianians drew from a deep well of anti-statist ideas to argue that the disaster was a problem of too much government, and therefore that the free market offered the best model for recovery. Others understood the catastrophe as a product of market thinking and called for a recommitment to the idea of a commonwealth, often through government action. Katrina was a call to arms for people in New Orleans and across the country, but it called them to opposing sides. Chapter 5 traces the development and implementation of the policies that remade Greater New Orleans after the flood, focusing especially on contests over housing, health care, and education. Although policymakers often couch their recovery proposals in the language of sudden opportunity or local necessity, the policies they proposed usually drew on long-standing and widespread ideas about social reform. Ultimately, political decisions reshaped the region more than the flood itself, dictating who was able to come home and what their lives would be like when they did. The explanation for why more than 90,000 African Americans did not return to New Orleans lies less in a deep and totalizing racist history than in the pointed and contingent work of comparatively recent actors. The epilogue explores cultural responses to the flood and the broader challenges posed by racism, capitalism, and climate change, which over time Katrina came to embody. In New Orleans, musicians Mardi Gras Indians, social aid and pleasure club members, and neighborhood advocates nurtured a vision of the future that foregrounded justice and community, one that conflicted with the recovery programs pursued by most policymakers. On the coast, especially after BP's Deepwater Horizon oil rig exploded in 2010, roughnecks, shrimpers, and other residents of fast-sinking towns shared the sense that the future imagined by those with power had no place for them. The land around them was disintegrating into the Gulf of Mexico. In the cities, suburbs, and on the coast alike, announcements that the time had come to retreat from rising seas often sounded like calls for dispossession, issued by those who would never make such sacrifices themselves. Meanwhile, as people burned the oil being extracted from and shipped through the eroding marshes, the world warmed and the seas rose higher. To those caught on the cross-currents of diffuse government bureaucracies and distant corporate structures, the levers of power seemed increasingly inaccessible. And yet, looking back on a century's worth of successes and struggles, Louisianians were becoming more aware of their own contributions, for better and for worse, to the world they had made for themselves and one another. What is a disaster? Disasters demand more attention from historians. The day after the 1915 hurricane made landfall, the New Orleans item announced city cut off from rest of world. The reference to downed telegraph lines resonates with the way many people have tended to think about New Orleans as an exceptional place, and disasters are exceptional moments, disconnected from the rest of time and space. In 2005, when President Bush called Katrina a tragedy that seems so blind and random, or when scholars argued that some array of factors conspired to make the eventual and inevitable disaster what it was, they suffered equally from the limiting view of Katrina as sudden break. Katrina was neither random nor inevitable, but both assessments are artifacts of seeing disasters as events without histories. When people face disaster, they reckon with fundamental questions. What should they try to save? What should they try to leave behind? And who should decide? Who deserves help? Why? What kind? And from whom? What caused the disaster in the first place? And what does this disaster mean for the next one? These debates, which ought to fascinate any student, scholar, or citizen, takes place in historical context. Sometimes these debates change the political and cultural commitments that give history its shape. And yet, perhaps because they are so often imagined almost by definition to be events that come out of nowhere, for a long time, academic historians largely ignored disasters altogether. Other social scientists embraced the study of disasters, however, and often explicitly because they seemed to defy history. In a seminal 1961 article, for example, the sociologist Charles Fritz argued that disasters provide a temporary liberation from the worries, inhibitions, and anxieties associated with the past and future, because they force people to concentrate their full attention on immediate moment-to-moment and day-to-day needs. Disasters, he wrote, cause the blanking out of the past and future frames of reference and provide a clean break from the past. A half century later, the author Rebecca Solnit argued that because they cause the suspension of the usual order and the failure of most systems, disasters leave us free to live and act another way. But Katrina's history undermines hope that, like Noah's flood, our catastrophes might offer a baptism by storm surge. Studying how a disaster took shape and place and over time makes clear that the places we live and the disasters that imperil them are produced by the same histories. The land underfoot and the ways people live on it, oil extraction, levee building, states' rights, suburban development, the middle class, coastal erosion, flood insurance, and jazz. The Mississippi River, Standard Oil, the Industrial Canal, the White Primary, the Lower Ninth Ward, Chalmette, the GI Bill, Fats Domino, the fried oyster po' boy, and the possibility that all of this will be washed away. This is Louisiana. Trying to disassemble these pieces makes history less comprehensible, not more. Better instead to try to figure out the ways they fit together. One seam in particular that many scholars have been eager to locate is the one that separates the natural from the man-made. Existing studies of disasters often turn on the question, as one investigation puts it, of where to draw the line between natural and unnatural disasters. To the extent that this approach leads to scrutiny of what or who caused harm to others, it remains a vital one. Increasingly, scholars assert that there is no such thing as a natural disaster because who is in harm's way is the product of political decisions and social arrangements, rather than the inevitable order of things. This essential point lies at the foundation of my analysis. Vulnerability is socially constructed. But to discover that any event is in some way man-made is simply to recognize the fact of human history, not to analyze that history. It is a starting point, not a conclusion. Rather than asking if a disaster was man-made, therefore, we ought to ask, how was it made? The answer will have to include nature and human nature, water and wind, concrete and clay, politics and culture, conscious choices, and unwilled accidents. Our sense of temporal scale, too, must change because the timelines of human and environmental history are intertwined. Burning fossil fuels has warmed the oceans, amplifying the frequency and intensity of tropical storms. Hurricanes are events in the history of the Industrial Revolution. There remains a crucial caveat. During disasters, some people suffer more than others. Disasters, therefore, compel their observers to confront inequality. For people trying to understand inequality, the idea that a certain amount of suffering is inevitable and that some people are bound to be unlucky, in other words, the idea that inequality is natural and that nature can be capricious, has proven to be a durably attractive concept. Sometimes people wield the idea as a shield, using it to hide their own culpability in causing harm. Other times, people use the natural disaster idea as a way to make sense of their own misfortune. Certainly, in ways this book explores, ideas about natural inequality and nature's caprice structure American law and social policy. Thus, it is necessary to reaffirm that so-called acts of God are deeply embedded in the acts of women and men, and at the same time to recognize that a belief in natural disasters shapes the way that many people respond to them. Acknowledging that disasters have histories does not mean asserting that those histories amount only to relentless teleological stories of decline. Many environmentalists and environmental historians describe disasters as nature's response to human efforts to engineer landscapes. They would paint New Orleans' physical expansion in the 9 decades following the 1915 hurricane as a defiance of the natural order, and Katrina, as the New York Times put it in a headline, as nature's revenge. This dim view leaves little room for the obvious truth that people have sometimes changed the world around them in ways that have made their lives better. To gloss the last century of Louisiana's history as a story of hubris, stupidity, and wishful thinking may be briefly satisfying in its moral sweep until one realizes that doing so gathers up Louis Armstrong, Ruby Bridges, Tennessee Williams, my wife Sarah, and over 1 million other Louisianians with all of their hopes, achievements, and beignets piled high with powdered sugar and deposits them in the dustbin of history's mistakes. On the other hand, casting recovery as disaster's inevitable second act is just as misleading. Many have gone so far as to claim that New Orleans improved after the flood, offering heroic tales of resilience, if not redemption. But even if these accounts did not celebrate changes that were and are deeply contested, they would remain bewildering to people who knew that at the immovable center of Katrina's story are hundreds of needless deaths. Asserting that the city came back better defames those who could not come back at all. This book looks back on a past in which terrible exploitation sometimes gave rise to extraordinary beauty, and forward to a future in which, we know, some of our most generous plans will give rise to extraordinary suffering. The disaster idea can obscure an ineluctable truth about historical change. Things get better, and they get worse, often at the same time. The more I've thought about Katrina and disaster studies, the more uncomfortable I've become with the idea of disaster altogether. A disaster is at best an interpretive fiction, or at worst, an ideological script. After all, there is no objective checklist for differentiating a disaster from other periods of time. You cannot distinguish a disaster from other bad news the way you can distinguish an alligator from a crocodile. When their mouths are closed, you can see more of a crocodile's teeth than an alligator's. Scholars have attempted classification schemes, but they rarely hold up to scrutiny. How many buildings must fall for an event to count as a disaster? How many people must die? Over what space or period of time? Squinting too closely at a problem can blind rather than focus your vision. Calling something a disaster implies that there is a regular course of things and that the moment in question was an exception. It suggests that the event was prompted by an exogenous force, that it was extraordinary rather than ordinary, acute rather than chronic, local rather than diffuse, unpredictable rather than expected, and revolutionary rather than evolutionary. And so just as slavery outlines the bounds of freedom, or darkness reveals the extent of light, the idea of disaster limes and affirms its inverse. Order. Consider housing. By making a special case out of flooding, the disaster idea normalizes the loss of homes due to economic change. There may be good reasons to distinguish between a person who lost her home in a flood and a person who lost his house because his mortgage went underwater, but preemptively deciding that these are categorically different species of events reinforces the political, economic, cultural, environmental, and moral logics that one ought to interrogate. Also, clinging closely to technical definitions is not likely to help us understand the pain of loss, the trauma of displacement, or the wondering why that accompanies any path to homelessness. Cordoning off moments when things go badly, the disaster idea enables us to perceive the arc of the moral universe as a long, smooth curve toward justice. To name something a disaster is to decry its outcomes as illegitimate and to call for a restoration of the status quo instead of suggesting that the status quo may have been illegitimate in the first place. The disaster idea makes enduring suffering appear to be a personal failure. And when people with power seem to recover quickly, the disaster idea allows them to celebrate themselves for beating the odds without acknowledging the ways that history had loaded the dice in their favor. Maybe the mistake we made right at the beginning, the sociologist Kai Erickson said to me in a conversation in 2015, was to call it Katrina. What I took him to mean was that it may have been a mistake to use the hurricane's name to refer to how the contingent histories of race, class, community, trauma, inequality, the welfare state, metropolitan development, extractive industry, and environmental change manifested themselves in Louisiana early in this century. A mistake because it risks misleading observers into thinking that the weather had made these histories matter, rather than the other way around. Furthermore, applying the storm's name in such an encompassing way risks implying that the story of Katrina should be something like the hurricane itself, blustering in, shaking things up, and then quickly dissipating. In reality, I argue, the disaster's causes and consequences extend across a century. When people talk about Katrina, they are not just talking about the storm anymore, one New Orleanian explained in 2008. It's the insurance crisis, the mental health crisis, the crime, the homeless under the bridge, the whole ball of wax. To continue to isolate the storm as a special moment in time, to name it as a proximate cause for any of these endemic and enduring social circumstances, amounts to a political argument against structural analysis. Removing the frame that the disaster idea imposes frees us to see a much more expansive view of how and why change happens. Disasters, so-called, are not so different from other moments in time. There often is more to be gained by bringing them down to the chronos of history than living them in the kairos of the sublime. Unless we are willing to escape into sentimentality or fantasy, Norman MacLean wrote in Young Men and Fire, often the best we can do with catastrophes, even our own, is to find out exactly what happened and restore some of the missing parts. That is what I have attempted to do. Part 1. 1. How to Sink New Orleans. Controlling Floods, Oil, and States' Rights, 1927 to 1965. Emile Riche knew the river across the road from his house in Bertrandville, Louisiana, as the Mississippi, but Choctaw people had called it Bulbansha, place for foreign languages. In 1927, many of the folks around Bertrandville, white, black, and shades between, spoke French. Emile's parents spoke French because they came from Alsace, but Attakapishak people had lived out on Grand Bayou since before the French arrived in North America, maybe since the muddy river had brought the land itself, and they too spoke French in 1927. Downriver toward Empire, Dalmatians spoke Croatian as they raked oysters. They traded them with Germans, Italians, and Irishmen, Spanish-speaking Filipinos, Chinese, Malays, Portuguese, English, Danes, Greeks, and Swedes. Across the Chandeleur Sound, along the Bayou Terre au Bouf, and on Delacroix Island, Isleño fur trappers spoke Spanish. They sang décimas they had brought with them from the Canary Islands. When the storms came, Isleño old-timers summoned the Spanish phrases that cursed the winds and the motions of the knife that might make the storms change course. It is unclear if the Choctaw word Bulbansha meant to signal a kind of cosmopolitanism or something more like babble. Nonetheless, on the signboards he posted around his property throughout the 1930s, 1940s, and 1950s, Risch painted his protests in English. English, after all, was the language that Louisiana Governor Orimel Simpson had used in 1927 to announce the plan to protect New Orleans from the Mississippi River flood. How? By dynamiting the levee across from Risch's home, blowing open a crevasse to lower the water level in the city. English was the language, too, that 50 leading financiers and businessmen of New Orleans had used in a front-page resolution assuring people like Risch, the truck farmers, fur trappers, and fishermen of Plaquemines and St. Bernard parishes who were flooded, that they would be given restitution for their losses. But over time, Emile Risch's experience taught him that the New Orleans businessmen treated their promises just as they treated that levee, as something to break. In the time of the crevasse, the burglars got $2,200 of my money, Risch wrote on one of his signs in 1955, nearly three decades after the flood, when he still had not been compensated. He added a simple appeal, I would like to know who the burglars were. The plea was a rhetorical flourish because Risch already had figured it out. There were many to blame, too many, but he focused on one man, Leander Perez. Perez was the district attorney for Plaquemines and St. Bernard parishes from 1924 to 1960, and during that long reign in what otherwise might have been an insignificant office, Perez made himself famous as an advocate for states' rights in the 1940s and as a segregationist in the 1950s. Risch called Perez the pocket drainer because of the way he secreted Plaquemines' oil deposits from the ground and cash from its constituents' pockets. Lording his control over coastal Louisiana's oil rights, the district attorney became a millionaire many times over. Firms large as Standard Oil and Freeport Sulphur supplicated before him. Above all, then, Perez distinguished himself as an autocrat, a man whose despotic control over local affairs made him seem to be a kind of American dictator. The New York Times called Perez the czar of Louisiana's greatest remaining sub-empire, who rules Plaquemines as a personal fiefdom. To Fortune magazine in 1958, he was the swampland Caesar of the last unconstitutional monarchy in the U.S. At home at Promised Land Plantation, his guests called him Judge. The irony, though, is that the political, economic, and environmental order Perez came to represent, one that gave a local politician the power to boss around thousands of well-armed people on their own land, to dictate to the largest industrial corporations in the world, to dare to reshape even the mighty Mississippi River for his own ends, would prove in the hindsight of history to be its own undoing. Perez ambitiously attempted to reform the National Democratic Party and Louisiana's image by helping to lead the Dixiecrat revolt. He pursued Louisiana's legal claims to offshore oil royalties all the way to the Supreme Court, and he enacted audacious economic, political, and even military plans to transform Plaquemines into a quasi-independent, self-sufficient parish. These efforts all backfired. Perez's life work as Mr. Dixiecrat, a name he gave himself to demonstrate his commitment to states' rights, ultimately eroded local power. Similarly, efforts in the name of flood protection ultimately made Louisiana more flood-prone. Today, The hundreds of millions of dollars spent on levees and canals are causing the place once known as the Empire Parish for its astonishing wealth and natural resources to disintegrate into the Gulf of Mexico. In 2013, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration removed 31 Plaquemines Place names from the official government map. The places no longer exist. Geologists warn that the majority of Plaquemines Parish may be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.